Hello, everyone. Welcome to another episode of OGT Live. I'm sorry it's been a small hiatus. We had a lot going on, and then we had anniversary parties and other events, unable to get to it, but we are back. We are back on our YouTube channel and Facebook. If you're watching from YouTube, Facebook, don't forget to comment, like, subscribe, all that good stuff. But also, more importantly, drop down in the comments what it is you're enjoying tonight, cigar, whiskey, scotch, whatever. If you're pairing anything, sometimes coffee, drop it down in the comments. I will pull it up, especially if you have any questions for our very special guest we have this evening. So a few things to bring up before we jump right into it. We have just entered into the third year of OGT, Oakland Tobacconist. So this is our third year. We just had our anniversary party. Big shout out and thank you to everyone who attended the party, everyone that continues to support us here at the shop. It's just awesome growing all together and growing with you guys and offering great cigars like the particular one that we have tonight. However, if you do head over to our Instagram channel, you will see this picture here. We are doing a giveaway. If you comment and tag three people who do not follow us and share our posts, we're doing a giveaway of the LCA drop that is tomorrow, which is Cigar Clowns the Ron, AJ Fernandez at his best, Cigar Clowns and Provada Cigar Club. So don't forget to do that. And also, I wanted to give a shout out for anyone who is an OGT Cigar Society member. So if you don't know or if you haven't heard what exactly that is, OGT Cigar Society is where we curate and we either have created or find sort of a rare, hard-to-find blend or Vitola, oftentimes a custom Vitola that doesn't exist outside of the membership. We send a 5-pack to all of our members across the country. They get to smoke one right out the gate with us. We meet on YouTube Live. You can kind of go back on our channel and see when we smoke those. And we also get to experience those together, and you get to age the cigar further. It's part of the journey. However, I've noticed we've started to see a lot more society members start to post on Instagram. So thank you all for sharing that. And I wanted to call a very special picture here. Boom. So this is a shout out to Mr. Ham, who has been a society member for some time, taking a picture of our latest release, See No Evil Shafio. This cigar I am absolutely in love with. It is a custom Vitola, so this size does not exist outside of the society. Talking to Justin, I love it is San Andreas, See No Evil. And so he agreed to make just our members a 6.5 by 48 box press Lonsdale, and it simply just pops. It's fantastic. So thank you. Shout out to the OGT Cigar Society. I see we've got a few comments here. We got Chris Hamilton on. Good evening. Heading home still. I hope you can maybe hear some of the show as you drive. We got Raider Dave. Good evening, Eric, Alec, and everyone. I'm pairing this video with a cooking dinner. Very nice. Awesome pairing. Love to know what you're making, too. Sounds great. So tonight, we are talking none other than one of my top picks for PCA 2022. Now, for those who don't know, as a retailer, when you go to PCA, you're trying many, many new things. And sometimes you don't even get to light up a particular new cigar at the time because of just different appointments you have and going different places. So you end up taking it home and trying it later. The particular cigar we're talking about tonight, I did light up at the PCA trade show and became one of the highlights for me. In fact, I lit it up the first day and I even put a few new cigars I want to try on hold to go back the following day and try it in all three sizes to see which one I enjoyed the most because I absolutely love this blend. It really speaks to creativity. It speaks to ingenuity and tobacco knowledge altogether. It's all rolled into one cigar. And unfortunately, I don't have a particular like glamour shot for you, but the picture that I posted, because when I got hold of this cigar, I had to celebrate our third year anniversary with it. I'm talking none other than the Casa Cuevas Sangre Nueva. So the Sangre Nueva, which all of the historical ramification, all of the context for the blend, its name and all such, will be given by our guests tonight. But I can tell you it boasts an amazing Cameroon wrapper, as well as a sliver of something very special within the filler of this cigar. And as you know, within the first year, I believe, of OGT, we started carrying Casa Cuevas. Fantastic blends. They're known as that kind of like rich flavor, full-flavored type of experience. I enjoyed the Flacos, the Limited, which unfortunately I think we've only got three left of. The Patrimonio, which is a fantastic Honduran Corojo. And then this new Cameroon, which, dare I say, I believe it has topped all the other ones for my personal palate. So a very, very special cigar. We got Jason saying, I'm having dinner, then enjoying a Cuevas Maduro Flaco. Very, very good choice. But this Cameroon, if you've heard me talk about Cameroon before, you know that it normally comes with two things. One, I absolutely love Cameroon tobacco. And two, I'm sort of a stickler about how it's used. In other words, Cameroon already is expensive. Cameroon is already difficult to get a hold of. Unfortunately, I feel like there's a lot of expressions of Cameroon that just don't reach the bar. There are some outliers that I absolutely love, like the Baca from Romacraft. I love the Hyena from Blackwork Studio. And now this new Cuevas is really making its mark in that line. In fact, it's one of my top favorite Cameroons. Smoked one a day or two ago, and it's an absolute pleasure that I get to smoke one now. So enough of me dribbling on. Let's have our guests join us. In fact, I believe the gentleman with us tonight might be the youngest guest I've had thus far, which isn't much saying because I'm not like an old, very old either. However, he is even younger than myself, and his talent is really speaking to this blend. If you have not tried Sangre Nueva, if you follow the link in this video, that'll direct you to our website where you can get an early 5-pack. In fact, this has not hit many shops yet. OGT has them right now. Very limited amount of 5-packs. You pick up a 5-pack, as I say, very limited. You save 10%. You also get a free Casa Cuevas cap, a Casa Cuevas hat. So fantastic deal tonight for this newly dropped cigar. I'm in love with it. I absolutely love it. And you get a great deal. It's kind of hard to beat that anywhere else right now. So head on over to OGT. That's where you'll find it. Just click on the link in this video. That'll direct you to the website. However, without further ado, let me introduce our guest, Mr. Alec Cuevas of Casa Cuevas Cigars. How's it going, man?
It's going great, Eric. How about yourself? Thank you so much for having me.
Oh, of course. Thank you so much for jumping on. I know it's kind of last minute, but when I got the green light on getting these shipped over to the shop, I was like, been waiting for this enough. Let's go ahead and make this happen. So thank you so much.
Of course, right on.
Awesome. So where are you? Are you at your house in Florida, or where are you coming to us from right now?
I'm currently, I'm in my backyard, so I'm still living with my folks, as most of y'all do know. As Eric just finished mentioning, I am still relatively young. So currently coming to you live out here in Miami, where the weather has been somewhat atrocious today, if I'm being honest, Eric.
Yeah, we're in an excessive heat warming here in California. Humidity is like above average, so it's not been very cool. You always hear that like California's fine, it's a dry heat. It's not what's really happening right now. So.
Exactly. I get you completely. Over here, it's the opposite. Over here, it's too much humidity. It hasn't rained in about a couple days or so. So today it just started pouring, and it's been like that for a couple hours. The only break we have is right now.
There you go. So I am super excited to light this up, but I haven't on purpose. I wanted to light this up because anyone who has tried the cigar, or for anyone who has not, should know, it is important to note, if you do not perform a cold draw on this, you are greatly missing out. The cold draw is spectacular on the cigar, and I'll let you dive kind of into it, but When I cold draw the cigar, you get that Cameroon sweetness, you get that earthiness, but there's something else there that immediately stands out. So what can you tell us particularly about this blend?
So about the blend itself, I wanted to go on ahead and release something within our lines that is very full in flavor. Initially, the project for Sangre Nueva, interestingly enough, was supposed to carry a full strength profiling, especially with the Cameroon. Similar to yourself, I'm a sucker for Cameroon. And okay. More than ever, Ecuadorian Cameroon is now coming into the fray of things, so it's much more easily accessible. I always wanted that to be the baseline for the cigar, and as most of you do know, if you do follow Casa Cuevas, last year we came out with our first ever Corojo Honduran wrapper, which would be our Patrimonio. Yeah. We also picked up a little bit of Corojo binder as well, and that is currently what we're using for Sangre Nueva. And the kicker is, like you said, found within the filler. It's a tiny little sliver of something I can't say just yet. I want the opportunity for the individuals currently following and for those that keep track of us and what we do to get your hands on it and genuinely see if you can figure it out. I'll give you a little hint, more so than not. It gives you this roasted sensation, hence why it's worth taking the cold draw. Once you end up lighting that cigar, a good maybe 5 to 10 minutes in, you'll see that it'll kind of mellow out and everything else will come forth within the stick itself.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, no, definitely. There is an immediate like sweetness, and then that kind of like lingering, very faint in the back, kind of that experience you have when you have like a Lagavulin or you have a Lafroy, like a smoky scotch. There's something in there, and it adds to the full experience. So we're going to delve into this particular cigar. However, just lit it up, and I will also say, for me, I always am a big fan of stronger cigars. And as you said, this was supposed to be stronger. However, this is like the best balance of full body, full flavored, while being medium strength. And it's just, it's like a bouquet of flavor. It's an anytime smoke. So it's a pleasure to smoke it every time.
Thank you, Eric, sincerely. The biggest thing, as you know, I've mentioned this a multitude of times with you, the fear factor of coming out with a brand new blend, especially under our company name and even more so under our family name. There's a big saying in which if I were to come out with a dud, let's say the first cigar, let's say it just bombed. My credibility is then lost coming out with the secondary cigar coming forth. So yeah. Genuinely to hear such good reception about the blend itself has just been tremendous. And as you said, you guys are one of the very, very few that currently have it at this very moment.
Awesome. Awesome. Yes. And I mean, I thank you so much for that. I was chomping at the bit, of course, when this would come into the shop. And so when we got the green light, we weren't able to get a lot. So it's a very small amount. Now is the time because you are not only getting the early setting on this, but you're also saving 10% and getting a free cap as well. So pretty awesome. But we do have a comment here I want to pull up from Uncle Larry. He's saying, how is the Cameroon from Nicaragua compared to the authentic Cameroon from Africa? Now, this Cameroon wrapper, though, I don't think is Nicaraguan. Where exactly does this come from?
So this is from Ecuador. And the reason that this came about was because we deal with, or let me back this up, better said, we own a factory, but we don't own any fields in which we grow tobacco. So we kind of have to outsource in a way. And we deal with a couple different companies on that regard, but one of which is from the Olivas, the Oliva factory over in Tampa, not to be associated with the brand itself, that going ahead and bring in plentiful bales of Ecuadorian product. With that being said, Ecuadorian Cameroon recently hit the shelves, and thus we were recently able to get our hands on it. But I would say the difference between the two, on a personal opinion, was that I do love African Cameroon. It adds a nice bit of bitterness to the cigar, but it's almost, how would you put it? It's a bitterness that works extremely well with black coffee. It adds to the flavor. Okay. It could even potentially work with a stout, let's say, if you were a beer drinker, which is something I normally wouldn't pair often when it comes to a cigar. So I think the biggest difference between the two would be that Ecuadorian Cameroon, albeit doesn't carry as much bitterness, it's still enough to which you get those sensations of that the nuttiness of the chocolatey notes of essentially what's supposed to feel as a very medium, well-balanced stick. You definitely pick that up with that Cameroon wrapper.
Yeah. So we got a few comments here from Vincent saying, do you guys are born in Pennsylvania?
Pensacola.
Yeah. or Tallahassee.
So initially, the brand, if you are referring to where the brand began here in Miami, Florida. If you're referring to whether we do business over there in Tallahassee and Pensacola, similar to California, Florida is an enormous state. And having proper boots on the ground makes it viably difficult, for lack of a better term, in order to get all across the state of Florida. So currently we're located, the majority of the shops, and we are located here in South Florida, if you do want to find our products. In relation to where our family's born, we are Cuban oriented. My father was born in Pinar del Rio, Cuba. That's where our legacy carries forth. And I'm the first of our family born here in the States, in Miami, Florida.
Okay. Awesome. And that's kind of where I want to start this. And if you're up for this, Alec, I want to try, I'm gonna let you take the reins on this. Maybe give us like a 5-minute like breakdown of kind of where you started, like what is it like growing up in, I think, fourth generation or fifth?
Fifth
generation cigar makers. Kind of where you started, where you kind of found your feet in the industry, and where that led to getting involved in your family's business. So I'm gonna let you take it and just kind of give us a rundown on that.
All right, sounds good. I don't really know where to begin. So growing up initially, we've always had the factory for as long as I've been around anyway. And this legacy, as Eric just finished saying, is five generations in. It began with my great-great-grandfather and then great-grandfather and so forth. to which my great-grandfather and my great-great-grandfather were cultivators of tobacco in Pinar del Rio, Cuba. Up until Fidel came by, confiscated all our lands, and my family started moving around up until they ended up here in Miami. So by this point in time, my grandfather already had the factory in the Dominican Republic, and my father was now jumping on board as of 2008. So we've been manufacturers of tobacco for a very long time and for a lot of other companies. At this point in time, I would spend my summers in the Dominican Republic because my grandfather is a workaholic and can't find himself leaving the factory anytime soon. It's something that genuinely keeps him going. So we would go over there at a very young age, me and my sister, just to visit at the very least, and also just check out the operation. It's something that always kept me in awe, but something I never really fully understood. I'd wake up early morning, go to see him. He'd give me a nice big old kiss on the forehead and say, "You go on ahead and start packaging. There's some nice ladies downstairs and they'll kind of teach you the ropes." So I would be packaging cigars left and right for hours on end, not yet smoking them. And I remember the earliest memory that I have of that, I was about 7 years old or so, and it was quite literally an 11-hour shift. Child labor aside, if you'd like to call it that, I had a hell of an experience every summer going over to the factory. But at this point in time, like I finished saying, never smoked a cigar, wasn't too familiar with the tobacco or the nuances per se. I just simply knew what was happening, so to speak, and what I was dealing with. So fast forward, I jumped through a multitude of different jobs, and I was still jumping into college at this point in time before I started working the retail aspect of things for cigars. At this point in time, the brand was already full and steady. So this was 2017. It launched April 1st of 2017, to be exact. And at that moment in time, I was working at Smoothie King. I was only there for a few couple months, but I had a lot of individuals in this industry tell me, "Hey, this is a family legacy. You most likely have a knack for this sort of stuff. And you should definitely visit this at some point in time, whenever you have the general knowledge or just the urge to go on ahead and jump into something different." I was very, very hesitant back in the day. And I remember sticking with that secondary job that I was working, not knowing full well where I'd end up going, up until working that retail location at Neptune Cigars down here in Miami. I consider them to be a secondary team because they were the ones that were one of the most educational when it came to learning about cigars, the immense amount of vitolas you could find out there, smoking just about everything that they carry in terms of their product. And I stuck with them for close to about a year, really learning the ins and outs about cigars, the proper way to cut it, or better said, even cigar etiquette. That in tandem with also my father being the president of the company, he would tell me a lot of the ins and outs as to what was going on business-wise, as to things that were occurring in the factory that I might not have known of at that point in time. So the actual blending process, how tedious it is, things like that. And then fast forward, the position in 2019 opened up for a new director of operations, to which I ended up jumping into the fray of things. So that is a little bit as to how I started coming in, but I really began my learning process when I got that position during 2019, because that was when my grandfather then decided to fly me over to the factory and legitimately show me the differences between tobacco, the drying chambers that we have, how certain things are organized there, how box pressed are made, which is another process in itself, very interesting. And if it wasn't for my grandfather really giving me that sense of information and that understanding as to where my culture has really led us to this point, I don't think I would have been as, how would I say, I don't think I would have adored this industry as much as I do now. Cigar culture is something that is lovely at that, something that I feel as if is very, very unique when it comes to most of the things you'd find here domestically. And the reason being is because you're able to sit down and have a proper conversation with whomever from all walks of life. And it wouldn't have been for those three potential factors. So Neptune's, my father, and then also my grandfather really teaching me the ropes of not only just the business, also the retail aspect of things, being a consumer, obviously, and then also the manufacturing side of things. I'd like to say that we are quite literally a jack of all trades when it comes to it. And all the education that I have currently inside this little cranium of mine, I owe to my family and all the wonderful individuals that kept me going this far. Eric, you're muted.
There we go. It's quite an undertaking. I mean, going from all of that and also seeing that tradition carried on through your families and stuff. What did your dad think as far as you like joining on to the crew inside the brand?
It was something that he always wanted, to be honest, Eric. And I remember even just from being very young at the age of about 12 to 13 years old and getting more of a grasp as to what my father was doing and the individuals that he was currently doing business with at that moment in time, way before the brands, he always yearned to have our name on a cigar going out into the field at a certain point in time, just didn't know when. And he always told me that I at some point in time would join him in the whole operation of things. He just didn't know when.
Yeah.
So moment came down to it, 2017 hit. And at that point in time, we already had a director of sales who was very well known in this industry. And God bless him, he passed away recently, Gabriel Alvarez, but tremendous help to our company. And that being said, all my position was at that point in time was packaging. I was very studious, still going through college, trying to finish with my undergrad and everything else. And going through that entire process, my father would always tell me every other day, you're going to jump into this full freight. You're going to come to understand things up until you're making your own blend. I never thought the day would come up until it came. And my father says, now you're fully integrated into this business. I could not be prouder.
Okay. Cool.
It was a very touching moment. It was.
So for those who don't know, actually how old were you when you started getting in the business? And how old are you now?
So starting to get into this business, I was 17 years old. That's also when I had my first cigar and I started working at the retail locations and so forth.
Yeah. Yeah.
And as of right now, I'm currently 23. My birthday is actually in about 2 weeks or so I'm going to be 24 soon, but currently I am 23. So definitely one of the younger faces found within this industry.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, and it's, I mean, I've said this before to some manufacturers who like will launch their brand, because we deal with a lot of boutique companies, will launch their brand with just one blend or two blends. And especially when it's like, well, their first blend they launch with is Connecticut Broadleaf or something like that. For the first blend you work on to launch a Cameroon is somewhat uncommon, I see, at least in the industry. It's sort of a bold move, but I'm definitely glad you did. It definitely worked. What is it like when you like blend it? You say, okay, like through the process, what are the channels it goes to until it hits the final stamp of, yes, we're going to produce this particular blend?
Wow. So for those of you that don't know this, the blending process is something that's tedious, very, very tedious. Finding a baseline as to where you want to go forth with the operation, or rather, better said, the project as a whole, is difficult. You smoke through a lot of cigars. This cigar alone was about 60 to 70 different cigars as a whole.
Okay.
Smoking up until we came across a verdict. I'd say everything else in relation to this, the process was starting off initially with 4 cigars. And the way it works in our factory is we traditionally use Toro when it comes to the blending size.
Okay. Yeah.
So Vitolas can be spoken about after the fact, but at that moment in time, we like the cigars to come fresh. And we can genuinely feel all the nuances that come with that cigar and if they complement one another. With Sangre Nueva, I started off with those 4 initial lines, to which number 3 stood out the most. And that was the one that currently carries the Corojo binder on it. The remainder, better said, had Habano, which is what we always tend to use when it comes to our binders, is Habano, a Habano binder from Ecuador as well.
Okay.
So immediately we had this baseline that came from the first initial 4 blends and I knew we had to work with it. I just wanted to add something more. And I kid you not, about 10 blends after the fact is when I got to a point where we were getting so close to the nail. And I remember looking at my grandfather and asking him, do we have anything else at the factory as of right now, unused tobacco that you could just potentially put in my direction that I could, that I could use? And he says, I think I have something there I can look for. And he came back with an itinerary. I came about with the one in particular that we went with. And I said, you know what, let's give it a go, which was blend number 10.
Okay.
This was an eight month long project to really settle down with this.
Yeah.
Yeah. And my grandfather flew in. He had the blend already created. And he says, I want you to go on ahead and light it up and let me know what you think. Because considering what we've spoken about before, the current thing inside the filler is very 50-50. People love it or people are very repulsed by it. It's one or the other.
Yeah.
So coming down to that blending process and finally lighting up the cigar and smoking it, the grin on my face was like no other. I was doing laps around my table. I knew we hit it right on the mark. And I couldn't have been more content. At that same point in time, we also discussed Vitolas. And that's also with the inclusion of the double perfecto, which is something brand new to Casa Cuevas.
Yeah.
We've used it with other companies before, but it's a new molding. I didn't necessarily want to go on ahead and release another gourd out. A 6x60s, it's personally not my palate. It works for a lot of people.
Yeah.
But I think that double perfecto, man, once you get to that shoulder and the cigar just blossoms on you, the flavors, it just, it really gives a nice oomph to the cigar.
Okay. Yeah.
You had to roll with it. So the process as a whole, as tedious as it is, was so much fun. And I have the utmost respect for my fellow manufacturers because it's not easy to come up with a blend.
Yeah. Well, I mean, yeah, it sounds like, I mean, I've even heard the horror stories, you know, you think you bank on it, you have your blend. Okay. Let's let it rest for a while. 3 months later, it's crap.
Yes. Oh my God. Yes.
There's that. We got another comment from Uncle Larry saying, I've seen Alec in a couple of interviews with his dad. He has great enthusiasm. So, that's a problem though with having you in interviews. You never smile. You never high energy. You're really, I mean, you maybe need to pick it up a few notches.
I'll do my best.
So, thank you, Larry. Now I know that is, I can only imagine that is probably the question that gets the most like tiring or the most old is always, what do you got something coming out new? Or what do you have something that's new? Because it'll happen even here in the shop, you know, a new product hits the shelf 3 days later. Do you have anything else new that came in? So it's always that chasing that. So I don't mean to add to that. However, how do you feel about box press?
Personally, I love box press. Folks, if you are a particular fan of Toros and you haven't had the opportunity to at the very least pick up a box press, I really recommend you do. It's essentially a Toro. All cigars start off rounds, and the process is you'll put, what we do anyway, the Cuban traditional way, is you put a concrete block on top of the cigars, let it sit for a couple months, and it'll retain its shape. You quickly have to go on ahead and put it into the box. Otherwise, it'll lose its shape immediately.
Okay. Okay.
It's very interesting how that works, but box presses smoke slower. They just add this sense of flavor. And they just fit well on your mouth. There's something about a box press that personally to me, it fits my palate. I love
it. Yeah. So, I mean, again, I'm not trying to add to anything, but I'm saying if you ever add a fourth Vitola of this, you know, I wouldn't complain if it was a box press. Just saying.
You know what? Food for thought. We've been, so similar to what you said, it does get a little bit tiring hearing if we do have new things coming out. But even then, I don't mind talking about it. We do have some stuff in the works for the future that I won't disclose as of just yet. But do be on the lookout for it, folks.
Definitely. However, well, and it's funny how you were discussing different Vitolas and how you're saying this is the first perfecto for Casa Cuevas. But you're also, I mean, you fall in love with a blend and then you're also presenting it in three different Vitolas. And I bet it's got to be interesting who gravitates to what, like size of like that. And did you find, like, I would say, I know it's kind of hard to pick. It's like picking your favorite children. But which would you say is your favorite Vitola of the three?
Double perfecto, hands down. That's not even a competition. The initial concept behind it was, and this was forever ago, when I was working at that retail location, I picked up a Rocky Patel 55, which also had the double perfecto tapered on both ends.
Yep.
The cigar really resonated with me. And knowing that we had that mold and just giving it an opportunity, especially with this blend, I think bringing this into the fray is a great benefit for the future of what we have coming out, because it could be something that we use in the nearby future.
Definitely. And it's funny because like I went back second day, tried all of them. And I loved the uniqueness of the Perfecto, but I love the punch that this Robusto offers. It's like, it's that feeling of like, we're getting into the tobacco that it just offers that I just love. And that's the beauty of cigar smoking preferences and finding all these different things. Which is really, really cool. So you guys launched, and PCA was the official launch. When do you suspect this cigar is going to be hitting more shelves?
So as of now, and for those of you that don't know, we've been having a little bit of issues when it comes to boxes. Happened to us similarly last year. So because of that, currently we're going to have it in our actual humidor for distribution purposes would be within 2 weeks, if not early September. So around the corner.
Okay, great. Great. Awesome. And that's always the nightmare, especially when it's like the blend is ready, everything's ready. But then the packaging your way, I can't imagine. It's gotta be such a word.
I'm already as stressed out as it is. As you know, my father doesn't have any hair to stress out with. So we're doing the best that we can, nail biting our way through the process. It's one of those things that's not within our control, so to speak, but like you said, having everything already prepared, and knowing that the cigar for the most part has received just relatively decent reception, I really want to put it out there for everybody to give a go. I really do believe that this brings something new to the table when it comes to what we already have in terms of product.
Definitely. Yes, definitely. And kind of while we're on the topic of that packaging, I don't know if you've kind of disclosed the how the band came about, which is a really interesting story.
Definitely. So this was at a point in time in which we were initially fiddling with the idea of what we were going to call it. We didn't even know, per se, what the blend was going to be. We just knew we wanted Cameroon, or better said, that I wanted Cameroon. And I was smoking a Habano earlier that morning, a Habano Robusto, as you know, Miami, hence why it was pouring all day today. It was pouring that day as well. Yeah. So it's just terrible conditions to smoke a cigar, if I'm being honest. Yeah. So I remember driving to the office, and we ended up getting stuck there because of the monsoon that was coming in. When I got back home, it was more or less 6 in the afternoon, I left the cigar on the front porch, still half smoked. And at this point, it was pushed all the way to the grass near the front of where we keep our parking. So the winds were violent. Aside, I came across a cigar right as soon as I stepped out of my car. And the band itself, I saw it and I was like, oh, that's where the cigar went. But I noticed the minute I picked it up that reddish coloration of that band changed to this bronze, this almost copper in color.
Okay.
Because of the humidity, because of the rain. And holy crap, it really stuck out. I mean, I took a photo of it and I was like, for future reference, let me keep this in the back of my head up until the moment came when we had to go and decide what the color was going to be for the band. And I was like, I think I have an idea, guys.
Yeah. And they're like, yeah, no, and it works. And I've said on many lives I've done before with you guys is that your guys' bands and cigars photograph better than most cigars. It's a beautiful graphic design. And it really, it's just the copper tone, I think, is representative of kind of what you experience. I don't know if you've heard of the term synesthesia before.
Yeah.
And I know there's even a cigar that's right now coming out from Crown Heads that is on that wave. But it honestly is very real for me. So sometimes I'll smoke a cigar, I'm like, this is green. I don't know how to say it, but it's very green. And this copper tone is really representative of the smoking experience to me. I think it works really well.
I wanted it to really be distinct. The colors that we tend to use, we like them to be very elegant, and we really like them to pop out when they can. But with this project in mind, and considering it's the very first blend that I've made, not only nerve-wracking and all that, you know, stuff pizzazz aside, the cigar itself, when it came to the band and the coloration, I thought was extremely important. This was a new stepping stone for us as a company, because I currently got promoted as director of brand development. I'm going to be working on a lot more of our blends going forward down the line.
Awesome.
And I really wanted to come in with a bang, and thus this was the coloration that we went with.
Yeah, nice. So we got another question. Rick Anderson is saying, what are the biggest takeaways you have learned from your grandfather and father, respectively?
Okay. There is a lot, Rick, if I'm being completely frank with you.
This is, now has turned into a 3-hour show.
At the least, for sure. I'll tell you what, I'll try to hit you with the most prominent points anyway that have really stuck out to me. Number one, like I said, that cigar etiquette. That is something my grandfather taught me on my very, very first cigar. Ironically enough, he taught me after the fact, when I was already just, I couldn't finish the cigar. I was halfway through a Maduro and I was like, what is happening? Is this not how you smoke it? And then he showed me the ins and outs as to the importance when it comes to vitola sizes. Because for many of you guys that don't know this, I didn't know this at a point in time. When it comes to Robustos and Gordos, you might think, if anything else, better bang for your buck, more tobacco, bigger size, and a longer smoking rate, which is very true. But that being said, you're smoking a lot more filler than you are the wrapper. Right. Hence why when you pick up a Lancero, let's say, as you know, I'm a sucker for Lanceros as well, you're smoking a lot of that wrapper and you genuinely get to feel and taste that transition when it comes to that cigar, whereas that might be a little more difficult when it comes to a Gordo.
Yeah.
So he taught me that. That was very, very insightful. And ever since that point, I've very much used it as an educational standpoint when it comes to consumers and even sometimes shopkeepers alike. And when it comes to my father essentially taught me everything I could have possibly imagined when it comes to cigars, in terms of what to expect jumping into this industry, in terms of believing in myself, considering I'm so young. And there was always this stereotype, I guess, if you'd like to call it that, in which this is meant for the older folk.
For
those individuals that like to golf or have something to celebrate. And that's not the case. Personally, I love smoking cigars at a very, very young age. That being said, He was one of the very few individuals that said, don't let the shop intimidate you. At the end of the day, you're going to like what you like. And the people in this industry are more than willing to help give you a certain educational basis as to where you need to go.
Yeah.
If it wasn't for those two tidbits, I don't think I'd be where I am today, if I'm being honest.
Yeah. Well, and kind of piggybacking on what you said about the value of like a Gordo or something, a bigger ring gauge, more smoke time. There's a video I did on our channel of what exactly is perceived value, because it's not the same for everybody.
Yes.
In other words, I mean, value, if like we're looking for the most money, most bang for your buck. So we're looking for duration. Well, sure. Bigger ring gauge and all that. But there's a lot of cigar smokers, especially here at my shop, that perceived value is through the flavor and the experience that you're having. And a lot of times Coronas, petite Coronas, that often will trump Gordos in value when it comes to flavor because of that richness.
I agree with that to a T. I personally find myself gravitating a lot towards Rothschilds. My fellow manufacturers create amazing products. Like that being said, before a brand owner, I am a smoker.
yeah.
But I love myself a good Corona, especially a petite Corona. Rothschilds really do some justice. I'm a big sucker for, actually I smoked this about 3 days ago, the Guardians of the Farm Coto that they have.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
I love that cigar.
Yes. I've currently been on a Lonsdale kick, as I kind of had mentioned earlier on the box press Lonsdale we had made. Like, I feel like you get that richness of a Lancero, but a little more comfortability in the hand. If you're not a fan of that, like 38 gauge, 40 gauge, Lonsdale just has this sweet spot for me right now.
It's a genuine sweet spot. In fact, it's funny. So my grandfather loves Lonsdales. Pardon me. I was about to say Lanceros. He actually doesn't like Lanceros at all. I don't know why, but anyway, he has recently been gravitating a lot more towards creating little house blends, for lack of a better term, in Lonsdale size. And every time he comes into the States, he'll bring a few for us to smoke. Even my grandmother, he has her smoking some of those as well.
Nice.
Normally not her cup of tea either, but she's very much enjoying it. I think that's a great size.
Yeah, no, definitely. So kind of starting on this journey that you are now, releasing your first blend, what would you say is one of the most difficult obstacles you encountered along that path?
Wow. An
obstacle that really stood out to you.
I'd say it would go down for the filler itself. As you know, in relation towards why we have this little sliver, to give you guys a gist, at our factory, we currently have certain individuals at this very moment in time handling this particular type of tobacco, because how it works is, as a roller, it's almost automated. They've been doing this for their whole lives, so they can multitask. Mm-hmm. And it's just grabbing a bunch here, a bunch there, and so forth.
Yeah.
So when it comes to that particular strand of leaf that we have inside the Sangre Nueva, you can't do that. Otherwise, you'll completely butcher the flavors you feel in a cigar.
Interesting. Okay. Yeah.
So that was the hardest part, was really nailing down how much is needed at this point where it simply won't overwhelm your palate when you want the cigar to be genuinely well-balanced and full in flavor. That was about a 3 to 4 month process after the fact. That's why it took so long to come down with a genuine consensus about it.
Yeah. Well, and I think that maybe perhaps I would say, venture to say, it's probably the contributing factor of why that particular tobacco you're speaking of has the reputation it does. It's because sometimes it's overkill and it's too much. And if it's a flavor you don't care for, it's not, at that point, it's not a way to bolster the blend. It is the blend. Mm-hmm. And so that's always why that, unfortunately, there's not a balance, I guess. And so I imagine, the journey, especially if you're going with 3 different sizes, because that's got to be corrected throughout.
Exactly. Sure. That became the other portion of the issue at hand. I think those were the two biggest obstacles standing out, but they both still related towards this particular type of tobacco. In the grand scheme of things, I wanted to stick with our slogan, which was essentially old traditions, new generation.
Okay.
So this does carry the legacy in which it's very well balanced. You still get a lot of flavor from it, but it's not going to kick you in your chest, you know?
Okay.
That's not something that we strive in as a company. We like our cigars to be very well balanced and for you to genuinely taste all the nuances there. Whereas in relation to this tobacco, I also wanted, hence the new generation, to bring in something that's more modern, for lack of a better term.
Okay. Yeah.
I almost spilled the beans there. But this particular type of tobacco, oh Lord, this particular type of tobacco hasn't been something that's it's been around for a good amount of time, but not nearly as long as you'd find some Nicaraguan tobacco, some Dominican, Cuban seed, things of that nature. So adding that into this blend, and like I said, it being experimental and seeing, whoa, this might be a little too much, let's try our best to tweak this as much as we can, became a challenge. It really did.
Okay. Yeah, for sure. Well, and I imagine, and I don't know if we've kind of broken down the name yet, of where Sangre Nueva came from.
So a lot of people in this industry, from brokers to fellow brand owners to shopkeepers alike, they see me walk through the door, and considering the knowledge that I do carry about cigars and the legacy that I have before me, young buck, young blood, new blood, all these titles would come out. And personally, I loved it. My father was like, don't let them ruse you like that. And I was like, but it's true. I am one of the youngest in the room more often than not. So
yeah,
when the title of this came about, Sangre Nueva stands for new blood.
Okay.
It's essentially my namesake, so to speak, in relation to this industry. But initially, the concept behind the name was going to be Sangre Joven, which stands for young blood. The thing is, translation-wise, it doesn't work too well. So yeah. Sangre Joven sounds German more than anything else, and these cigars don't come with a side of bratwurst. So
at the end of the day,
I have to kind of change that up a little bit. Regardless, it still carries the same meaning behind it, which is literally new blood. I'm trying to bring something new within this industry, and being one of the youngest here, I really want to make my impact as much as I can, especially for our company.
Yeah. Okay. Definitely. And I mean, I don't know if you guys on camera can see as much smoke as this thing is producing. Like, it's one of those cigars when you, and it's, I'm always finding myself enjoying cigars that produce a lot of smoke, but even especially in this setting, I'm like having to blow it away from my face because it is such a smokestack. But I mean, that's what a lot of smokers really enjoy. I mean, Drew Estate is kind of known for that type of experience.
Oh, yes.
But it's a very satisfying experience for certain. And I think too, people get, unfortunately, they get the concept of full body and full strength mixed up. So how would you break down full body, full strength, like how body and strength are in their own categories?
So when it comes to being full strength means full in the sense where you get a lot of flavor from your stick. So in this case, you're picking up some bitter tones, but they're working very well with some spiciness to your cigar, or maybe even a creamy note that you personally weren't expecting. And hell, even a few cigars give you a citrusy note. There's a floral tone, so to speak. So that's what I would go on ahead and constitute as full strength, whereas full bodied, in my opinion, is those cigars that carry a lot more ligero, or more jam-packed. It's more it's more nicotine oriented.
Yeah, so okay.
It's one of those where if you don't have a proper dinner beforehand, it would most likely make you sweat.
Now, are there any cigar brands or sticks in the industry that you enjoy that kind of fall in that full strength category?
Yes. So La Galera, they create this specific cigar, which is very interesting to note. The size in the Vitola, going back to it, I love the shorts. It's called La Vitola. Literally, the cigar is called La Vitola.
Okay. The size.
Yes. It's just, I can't even tell you the size. It's extremely short. And okay. Holy cow, that cigar put me on my butt. Very, very strong, full-bodied. At that point in time, I made the mistake of not having any lunch beforehand.
Yeah.
But you'd be surprised. It's a nice little box pressed. It essentially is about an hour-long smoke if you genuinely savor it. The flavors you get out of that cigar, Eric, are just stupendous. I mean, they're just...
Okay, I'm going to have to check it out for sure.
And another one I'd say off the top of my head, the way Wayne say Maduro, it doesn't come off as the strongest Maduro, so to speak, in relation towards what you can find out there, but it has such a good, very well-versed balance when it comes to carrying that strength, or better said, that body profile. That's another great stick. Very chocolatey notes, but really chocolate, almost like cacao in a way. So the initial origination of chocolate.
Right.
Love about the cigar. Super savory.
And in this world of kind of like in the cigar industry that we are now, it is such a fantastic time to be a cigar smoker because you have such amazing brands coming out. But one thing I did notice in PCA is a lot of new boutique brands. And unfortunately, in experiencing some of those brands, in attempts to find that strength, that full like hit you in the face, it sometimes is attributed to like under fermentation, and you start noticing that in the back of your throat, that ammonia, and it's like, well, yeah, this is strong for sure, but it sacrifices so much in terms of flavor and even complexity. So that's always, I imagine, the delicate balance too. If you're aiming for something stronger, you can't sacrifice those things.
Yes, you can't at all. It really takes away from the cigar. If you want a chest kicker, you want that triple Maduro, that's fine. Just know what you're setting up for. And at the very least, don't be disappointed when you don't really find the flavor within that cigar itself.
Yeah.
Very, very hard to balance both of those things together. So to really come up with a cigar, hence why I said the utmost respect to my fellow manufacturers, mm-hmm. to come up with something as well balanced as that, that still carries its oomph, but it has so much flavor to it, is very hard to do. Very, very hard to do.
Yeah, definitely. So we have an interesting question here, kind of in that vein. And I think it would be interesting if you kind of give your answer and then I'll answer him as well. Being from a cigar, let's remove retail, let's remove manufacturer from a cigar smoking side and enjoying it. So Rick is asking, as someone who is very new to the hobby, what are some of your favorite beginning cigars? So what are, like, let's say like three that you would like. I could recommend this as a beginning. I think you'd enjoy it. It's a good way to start.
Yes, and I agree with that as well. I would say, if anything else, I personally would say, Rick, don't be afraid to try certain Maduros. Like, for example, I love our Core Line Maduro. Not to hype us up or anything like that. I'm very unbiased, as you guys know. But our Core Line Maduro is medium-bodied, clean break under the head. It's not going to overwhelm you in the slightest when it comes to that. I'd say as a nice starter, most people gravitate towards this, and I don't see why not. I do like the Perdomo Champagne. It's also a nice starter. I think it provides a little more flavor than your Monte Cristo Whitewood. And if you're looking for something a little bit more, which is a nice little transition stick for you to see where you're at palate wise, you can also give a go with the Rose of Sharon by Southern Draw.
That's a good cigar too. Yeah.
Amazing cigar. I love that. I love that. Yes.
Definitely. And that's, and Rick, that's something you've probably already heard. And it's something I guarantee you're going to hear as you start out, is it's always Connecticut's or flavored. But what Alec really did well is he offered three different types of blends that are our entry, and kind of piggybacking on that, a really good Connecticut, if you're looking in that Connecticut realm, is the Casa Cuevas Reserva, the natural, because you have that creamy note, you have a little bit of citrus on the back end, it's nothing overwhelming, but it's a good test to be like, is Connecticut flavor really where I want to be? Because that's a good like representation of Connecticut tobacco. Yes. So I would definitely recommend something like that. In that Maduro side too, Blackbird Cigar Company makes some really good ones. They do one called the Unkind, which is more medium, chocolate bar-esque, really, really good. And if I'm speaking truthfully, inside our humidor, I know that you guys, I saw a video that you were with Tim of Cigars Daily.
Yes, sir.
His brand, American Viking, he's got some really amazing ones. Filthy Vikings in there. But the good thing is, Rick, is that you have all the best cigars you're ever going to smoke lay ahead of you. Because you're just starting out. And so that's a really awesome place to be.
It's a great experience. It really is.
So kind of as we wrap up into like our final questions beforehand, what did you discover about your palate when working at the shop you did and then working in the factory? Like, where have you found this is where my sweet spot is, kind of knowing your palate?
It's very difficult. So this will piggyback on something else. It's very difficult for me to tell you what my all-time favorite would be. I've come to the understanding that I really do like everything across the gamut, but I can most certainly tell you things that I personally don't really care for too much.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah.
One of those things in particular is when a cigar is extremely, extremely bitter and there's nothing else to show for when it comes to it.
Yeah.
I feel as if, at the very least, you can do a lot when it comes to cigars that add that bitter note. I find it to be an accentuator of sorts, similar to Cameroon, for example. There's some companies out there that really do their justice when it comes to creating a nice, very well-balanced, bitter yet creamy smoke.
Yeah.
And I've also come to the understanding that if the cigar doesn't have any flavor at all, I have a very hard time smoking it. I'm a firm believer that you should smoke every cigar at the very least twice before you give an honest opinion on the matter. But there have been a few of those out there in which I've given a multitude of times just smoking whenever I'm granted the opportunity. And to this day, they still just don't do anything for me.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, and that's always the travesty too, when you're getting new into it and you are, you are suggested so many Connecticuts, because often than not, that bitterness is very existent in Connecticut blends sometimes. So finding ones like the Cuevas Natural I mentioned, or the Champagne that you mentioned, that really, if any bitterness is in it, is extremely subtle. It's not something you really pick up on. Yes. Are where those good representations are. And yeah, I mean, we actually did a tasting for a cigar where it was not, there was no sweetness, like zero sweetness. And the only way to detect any form of it was if you retro. And we're in a group of about 20 of us. And I would say 50% of us actually retro. So if you're not retroing, it's a very one note cigar.
Yes.
And so there's finding those avenues. Yeah, I would definitely agree for sure.
Definitely.
So towards the end here, these are a few questions I kind of asked some of our manufacturers just as curiosity. One being is, how many cigars a day do you suppose you smoke?
Do I give you the podcast answer or the online or the
ballpark? Yeah. Ballpark.
On average, I would say I smoke at the very least about 5 to 7 cigars a day.
Okay. What if you're at PCA?
Oh Lord, we both know, Eric, that number just doubles.
Yeah.
A lot of smoking to be had at those trade shows. By that point, I'd be hitting about that 13 to 15 cigar mark.
I imagine if you're blending, you got to build up that tolerance because it's nonstop trying tobacco. So yeah.
Okay. And at the very least, it also helps to have a little bit of Coca-Cola when it comes during the blending process, just to clean your palate. Because after a while, you're right, you're put on your butt. I mean, it's a lot.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Okay, and what would you say are some brands as a whole? Let's not talk blends, but like brands, like as their portfolio, that are inspirations to you as far as like the family and creating your own portfolio.
I personally am a huge fan of Espinosa. Not only are they good friends of ours at that, but that being said, they make some tremendous cigars. Another relatively boutique. Yes, they are freaking tremendous in my opinion. I love Oliva. Oliva in particular, well, better said, the Nub series.
Okay.
It was one of the very, very first Cameroons that I ever got my hands on, and it was such a distinct size that bringing this into the fray now, coming forth with different types of vitolas that we're able to actually get mold-wise, they came out with something extremely unique at that point in time, something that a lot of other individuals were very fearful of doing, which is creating a relatively larger gauge cigar, but much mm-hmm. shorter in length.
Yeah, yeah.
You don't find those very, very, or now maybe it's a little more prevalent, but back then it wasn't something you'd come across very often.
Yeah.
Plus that Siri V. Milano is just tremendous. I love that cigar.
Nice.
There's a few from AG's line that I genuinely love. The Ashton Classic is one of the very, very first Connecticuts I've ever smoked.
Okay. Okay.
And I like to use that comparison when it comes to our regular Core Line Connecticut. They're both just as flavorful, and it carries that sweet hints that you find inside the Classic as well.
Okay.
So those are some of the very few that, at the very least, I very much gravitate to.
Nice. Now, we're also in a time where the cigar industry is shifting, as it's overshifting, but I feel like it's pretty exaggerated at this point. What's it like, or let's say, name one major struggle that you have being on the Sangre Nueva side, new blood to this industry and trying to convey some new ideas, new ingenuity to a very traditional industry.
You can't teach an old dog new tricks. That is, and I understand it's a saying, but it is a pretty prominent problem for the individuals in my generation coming into the fray when it comes to cigars as an industry as a whole. A big fear factor that I know of a plentiful of individuals my age is the intimidation. Walking in, not knowing what you're doing, and getting the educational standpoint forward. Being the youngest in the room, when I had that educational background, most individuals, if I don't necessarily have any sort of relation in, you know, in comparison to the conversation, will dismiss me more often than not.
Okay.
So it becomes a big problem of credibility at this point in time, hence why this cigar was such a big deal for me. I might be the youngest in the room, almost maybe even at all times going forward up until a certain age. But that being said, I have an enormous passion for what I do. And really getting that across and having individuals understand that and having their eyes sparkle when they genuinely see how much I care about this, I think is a huge treat. But also a double-edged sword is one of the biggest problems I think I have.
Okay. Yeah. No, I definitely see that for sure. Yeah. I mean, it is a very traditional industry, and you see a lot of different companies kind of being innovative. Some of it works, some of it doesn't. And unfortunately, the ones that don't work end up kind of scarring the idea of changing things up.
Definitely.
So definitely a struggle. And then also, what would you say is one of the most interesting experiences you've had, whether negative, whether positive, at a cigar shop, at an event, at a trade show? What would you say?
So I there's a couple different stories I can go off of here. I think one of the most interesting has a very, oddly enough, special place in my heart. I once went to an event over in Lake Havasu. They had this beautiful distillery over there, and they were at this point in time doing a pairing when it came to cigars. After the initial instructions and the educational factor was all over and everybody was enjoying their drinks and whatnot, I ended up realizing, a little bit too late, better said, that the majority of the individuals in there were swingers. Something. So, to give you the short story in relation to this, it took me way too long to come into terms with this. And between being hit on here and there and that and the third and understanding what was occurring, I didn't come into concept of it up until we got into the car and we're driving back. And Brandon Wells, which was our broker over there in Arizona, says, "You did not realize what just happened there, do you?" I said, well, no. And he says, "She wasn't talking about the cigar. She was talking about something else about it." And that was possibly one of the most – it was such a weird night. And yet there was some of the nicest people I think I've ever met.
Yeah. But interesting conversations for sure.
Yes. I don't think I've ever experienced that in any sort of cigar shop before, especially not when I completely misread the initial concept of, oh, how does your Habano taste? And I went into the intricacies as to what the taste. Still pretty naive. I'm picking up on certain things, but I'd say that was by far one of the most interesting notions I've ever had at a cigar shop.
Sure. Great. Well, yeah, definitely something that you won't forget. You'll always associate Lake Havasu with an experience like that. Well, I want to thank you so much for jumping on the show. And for those who are watching, if you haven't picked up a 5-pack, they are available at OGT. Get 10% off, plus a Casa Cuevas hat. Follow the link in this video. That'll direct you to where they're at. Very limited amount, but this is definitely, if you're a Cameroon fan, medium strength, but full in body, full in flavor. Don't miss out on this one. This one is an incredible cigar. So, Alec, thank you so much for spending time with us tonight.
Thank you guys so much for having me.
Definitely. And so for everyone out there, thanks for joining in the comments. Have a great night, and we'll see you next time.